we will also do some part of the static, that is the basics of environment. Today's class depends on how it goes. Okay, so good. So we'll start. We'll also do our rapid fire as we always do wherever it is required, so that you guys, whoever knows the answer or searches the answer, I'm perfectly okay with both. You need not know the answer. You can even search in Google and share it with me, so that at least the engagement is there. Okay. Genetic profiling of swamp deer. So there is a name for swamp deer in Hindi. You could say Hindi. Locally, how do we call the swamp deer? There's another name to it. Does anyone know the name? And it's also linked to antlers, means as in any idea what is it called? Yeah, excellent, Shaunli. Barasingha. It's called as Barasingha. Singh means, what is Singh? The horn. So Barasingha. So it is meaning that it has 12 horn within horn. I mean, if you have seen it, it's almost like a reindeer. The look of it almost looks like a reindeer. Yeah, Singha is horns, correct. So it almost looks like a reindeer. So you will see that there is a horn, but within that it branches off. It looks as a tree. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Yeah. So it is found in the Gangetic Plain, and it's also found in the Sharda Basin. So whenever you see something like this, what is the first thing that you need to do? You need to Google and find where Sharda River is. You will figure out that it is in the Nepal UP region. Okay, it's in the Nepal UP region, but please do Google and find out Sharda. Once you look at Sharda, you will maybe know some of the other areas. This is how you strengthen your knowledge of some of the locational aspects, because if you just look at 50 locational aspects at one go, you will not be able to memorize. As you keep reading the newspapers, keep adding these points on the map, and the mind takes some time to absorb them. So please do it little by little on a daily basis, rather than taking tons of it and trying to finish it in 4 or 5 days. That will not work. Okay. Now, with their numbers estimated, okay. So Dudhua National Park. So what am I interested in? Okay, they are saying 3,000. I really don't have to worry. Means as long as, okay, so there is some number. It's not very bad. Dudhua National Park. So Dudhua, we also discussed Dudhua in a different context. Any idea if someone can remember? Dudhua was also, Dudhua is national park, but it is also a, can someone tell me, it is also a, in addition to a national park, it's also a? Excellent, excellent, Anand. Tiger reserve. It's also a tiger reserve. Guys, do you remember those, what do we call, tiger conservation units that we discussed long back? There was India map, green color India map. Then I had drawn, hey, totally there are, this many number of conservation units. By any chance, do you remember? For example, I would have said that there are 7 conservation units. Does anyone recollect it? And then we said one is the Terai belt, then there is a Northeast belt, then there is a Eastern Ghats belt, then there is a Southern Western Ghats belt, then there is a Central belt and all that. Yeah. So your Dudhua is part of your Terai belt. Terai, can you imagine Terai? Yeah, which is your India and Nepal boundary approximately. That roughly corresponds to Terai. Okay, so it's also found in Kanha National Park. So that's a good lead, no? Kanha is also has tiger. Dudhua also has tiger. Barasingha is there both. So you can easily attach a predator-prey relationship between both of them. Okay, protection status, I have made it bold so that this is something that you should try and remember. One or the other way they will try to judge your understanding or knowledge in this. IUCN is vulnerable. So vulnerable is not bad, no? Because after vulnerable, you have endangered, critically endangered, extinct in the wild, and extinct. So as far as its conservation status is there, it's not bad, which is reflected in the numbers also. 3,000. But IUCN is worldwide, no? So you will find these swamp deers in many places. So it is still vulnerable, considered as vulnerable, but it is not endangered or critically endangered. However, sites, yeah, that lists it in Appendix 1, which means it is a wild animal of concern, especially from a trade perspective. Similarly, in our Wildlife Protection Act also, it is put under Schedule 1. Now, one of the reasons why impacting their population is for both these antlers as well as the meat. Antlers as well as the meat, and it is sold in the local market. So in many places, this deer meat is a delicacy. Yeah, so people eat the deer meat, and off late. So as the name itself suggests, swamp deer. Yeah, so deer which you find in area which is a little swampy, marshy, where it has wetland, some amount of wetlands. So obviously, whenever the wetland gets reduced, it is threatening the habitat of these swamp deers, and therefore their numbers are reducing. Okay. Swamp deers are highly gregarious and nocturnal. Nocturnal, any idea what is nocturnal and what is gregarious? Any idea? I mean, it's not environment, it's more of English. Yeah, nocturnal is active inside. Excellent. Gregarious. Okay, gregarious is social. Okay. Any other point? Somewhat right. They form a societal. They are together. You could say that, Prachi. I think yeah, social. You could say any other explanation. Yeah, live in clusters. Exactly. So they move together, live in clusters. They are social. They are herds in packs. All of them are right, guys. Huh? So they are highly gregarious and nocturnal. So sometimes what happens, no, I have not seen this in UPSC. At least some of these institutes ask questions like this. They give a characteristic of sometimes not animals, but of national park. They say this river passes through it. This is to the south, north, etc. Identify the national park. It helps. Similarly, also look at some key features of these animals also. Yeah. So, for example, if they say, you know, these species are highly gregarious and nocturnal, they are found in the Sharda basin, and they have eyesight and hearing that are moderate. Some clue they will give, and then you can, between the options, you should be able to figure out which one seems to be the most appropriate answer for the given set of clues. Okay, so they are doing what? They are doing genetic profiling. So more details, you can look at it from this article in the Hindu newspaper, genetic profiling. So you do genetic profiling primarily to assess how diverse the genetic diversity is. That gives you an indication that if at all there is any threat due to outbreak of diseases, how good a chance do these swamp deers have in terms of survival. Okay, so that's why we do genetic profiling. Let's move on to the next one. Captive bred gharials released in Bias River are thriving well. So there were actually two news articles. So I have pasted it at the top and the bottom. Go back to our class where we discussed this crocodile breeding and management program. I hope you remember. We looked at three species oriented projects. If you remember that, so one was Project Tiger, other was Project Elephant, and third was the Crocodile Breeding and Management Program. So this also started way back in 1973. And we said that the National Sanctuary in Chambal is where the Crocodile Breeding and Management Program, that's the place where it all kind of started. One of the objectives of Crocodile Breeding and Management Program, as the name itself suggests, Breeding and Management Program. So what was the purpose? The conservation, let's say in this case, the Chambal, yeah, river sanctuary, the conservation or the protected area for this crocodile, the purpose is that it acts as a breeding nuclei. You remember it? Breeding nuclei. This is the word I have used a couple of times. Nuclei. Yeah, breeding nuclei. So you make sure that the population of crocodile increases. When it increases, you transfer the, you know, baby crocodiles, so to say, to a area where they used to be there 20, 30, 40 years before, but now they are extinct. Bias River exactly fits the bill. Are you able to understand? That is why, interestingly, these are also called as reintroduction program. In crocodile, you will hear this word reintroduction program. So what is reintroduction program? You are introducing crocodile in an area which is its erstwhile habitat, because there you know that since these crocodiles, in this case we are referring to gharial, so which is a fish eating crocodile, in this case we know for sure that the gharials existed in the Bias River till 1960s and they become extinct. Therefore, if I'm able to transfer some of these gharial from the Chambal sanctuary to Bias, there is a greater chance of surviving because it was their erstwhile habitat. So this came in for a lot of, cheers or happiness among the wildlife conservationists because it is believed that this reintroduction program was being done from 2017 onwards. Okay, 2017 onwards, and 94 is a good number. So what they have said in the article is also out of 94, only two have died, 92 have survived. And the most interesting part is they have all been reintroduced as baby crocodiles, and it takes them around 7 years to reach a stage where they are ready for reproduction. So that 7 years has not happened. So that 7 years is going to happen in the next 2 to 3 years. After that, the population may increase much faster. Okay. So this will be a very successful reintroduction program should it really succeed. And by all means, it seems to be succeeding. Okay. And some points about gharial. So this is about the program itself. This is about gharial, the fish-eating crocodile. One feature I found interesting was this term called sexual dimorphism. And it's also an indicator of a clean river. So you could even call it as an indicator species, so to say. Means more crocodile in a river, among other things, means that the river is clean. Okay. So sexual dimorphism means by looking at this gharial from a distance, you can identify whether it's a male or female. And the identification is not with respect to the reproductive organs. The identification is with respect to some other feature not related to reproductive organs. For example, in case of birds, when you say, you know, this bird species exhibits sexual dimorphism, what it means is you can see, just a random example I'm giving. So, okay, so the males are all, you know, dark purple and the females are light gray. So I don't, from a distance, I know which is male and which is female. Yeah. Maybe the male has a particular type of beak, the female has a particular type of beak. So in this case, the male are the one which have a bulb-like structure on its snout. You know the gharial, right? It has a lengthy, what should I say, jaw maybe. And at the end of the jaw, means at the start, I don't know whether to call it start or end, this part. Yeah. So if you see gharial, so if it opens its mouth, so this is, let's say this is your gharial, yeah. So this is your gharial here, this part. So it has a snout. In fact, they say this snout, the local population calls them as ghara. Ghara is pot. So it looks like a pot. So pot-like structure, when you find it on top of the upper jaw of the gharial, so that's why they are calling it sexual dimorphism. So you can look at it and tell whether it's a male or a female. Reason for extinction, I think we all know, not very, very different. So reason of for extinction, you can read it for yourself. Places where gharial is present. I think this is important. We know for sure the Chambal River, it's a sanctuary. Sone, yeah, Sone, Kane, Betwa, some of the tributaries. Girwa River, see where Girwa River is. It happens to be coming from Nepal. Ganges, we know. Mahanadi, we know. Chambal also, we know. Yeah. So please take up the atlas and start looking at these rivers. It is important. Okay. Protection status. Despite the numbers, because it's only increasing a little bit, it is still classified as critically endangered under the IUCN and Appendix 1 and Wildlife Protection Act Schedule 1. So it is topmost conservation, topmost priority for conservation across the world, not just in India, but across the world. But overall, this seems to be a positive news that they that the reintroduction program. So reintroduction, why? Because they have been introduced back into their erstwhile habitat. That's on gharial. Dolphin boom in Odisha's Chilka Lake. So it's called Chilka in some place. It's called Chilika also. Both are the same. So we all have seen dolphin either in person or at least a photo or a video of dolphin. Usually as playing and used for entertainment purposes. They obviously exist in their natural habitat also. It is said that during the COVID time when there was less tourism in and around the Chilka Lake, the population of dolphin has almost doubled, more than doubled actually. And the dolphin itself has many species. So the three species that are found in Chilka Lakes are the Irrawaddy dolphin, bottlenose dolphin, and humpback dolphin. Okay, so whenever we imagine dolphin, no, we always imagine dolphin. When we think of dolphin, we have, you know, something like this, no? I don't know, something like this, yeah. So this is bottlenose dolphin. Okay, The interesting thing, I saw the picture of Iravati dolphin. It hardly looks like a dolphin. This is not there. So it just looks like this, with a mouth like this, almost like any other fish. Yeah, please do check the photo of Iravati dolphin. It's very different. If someone told me it is dolphin, then only I'll believe it. Otherwise, it even doesn't look like a dolphin, but it comes under the one of the subspecies of dolphin. Okay. Then comes your red list, endangered, appendix 1 of sites, and schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act. So the reason for, yeah, so in this, some facts about Chilka also helps. I did not mention any facts about Chilka because I'm sure in geography you would have read about it. The brackish water lake, India's largest brackish water lake, and some of the other features of Chilka Lake. Dolphins, once again, exhibit, just like gharial, sexual dimorphism. What is it? From a distance, you can identify which is a male and a female. So the males are usually larger than the females. Like many of so let me not tell that. They have a layer of fat or blubber under their skin, it seems. Do you know any other species that has a fat or blubber under the skin? And you can get the clue by looking at the remaining part of the answer. To keep them warm in cold water. Any idea? Fat or blubber? Polar bear, penguin, seal, excellent. All of them are right. Blubber. Yeah. So all of them are right. So usually blubber is a fat, and fat is not heat conductive. Fat is an insulator. You understand the meaning of fat. That's why you will, even in my friend circle, when I was working in NTPC, we used to joke around people who are a little hefty because they never really used to feel very cold so soon. But the slimmer ones used to feel very cold, you know, as if the cold is hitting them in the bones. Yeah, but the ones who are relatively so-called healthier, in Delhi they call them as healthier, they have an additional layer of what is called as adipose. Heard of this adipose tissue, which is a fat tissue. So that acts as a thermal insulator. So the moment you have a thermal insulator, it really helps in polar region. It also helps in and around Delhi for sure. I've been there. That's about a very quick take on dolphin. And it is important because I think we generally think of dolphins as being in protected reserves, but they are also in their natural habitat. In Ganges, we talked about Ganges dolphin. Here we are talking of three different species of dolphin, both in Chilka Lake as well as in the open sea, as in the Bay of Bengal itself, outside the Chilka Lake as well. So this is a 15-year program called as the Indian Rhino Vision. So it was started way back in 2005. So in 2005, they started. In 2005, it was started saying that in the next 15 years, that is 2020, which is already gone, we will increase the population of rhino from 2000, which was the value then, to 3000. So it's quite an ambitious target to increase it by 50%. But this was only one target of Indian Rhino Vision. The second target of Indian Rhino Vision was we will disperse the population. So the second objective was we will disperse the population from areas where their density is high, like Kaziranga. Okay. Like there is this Orang National Park, etc. to some of the other forests of Assam, forest and national parks of Assam. So there were two objectives: increase the population and increase the dispersal, that is the spread. Who were the organizations that were present? It will help if you remember. Now, the reason why I picked up this news was, if you remember, if you go back to this one, I'll go a few slides forward. Yeah, this one. This guy. West African black rhino. It is declared as extinct. Yeah, but in India, we still have our rhino, luckily we have almost touched it. I'll say when I complete the topic. So we have touched 300 rhinos. So that's why this Indian Rhino Vision becomes important in the light of loss of some of the rhino species in Africa. Okay, so that's how you relate to this topic and give it the necessary importance. Otherwise, there are too many initiatives present everywhere. Why do we have to read all of them? Okay, so that's the reason why I have taken this news article. Indian rhino population. So this we have discussed. You know, when I was looking at this news article, the other thing that came to my mind was, I don't know if it has come to your mind, Assam as a state is rich in biodiversity, okay, has a lot of national parks. In fact, which is the next article that we are going to, next news item that you're going to study, is a lot of national park, is also subject to a lot of poaching. So this news article itself came when two rhinos were released into the Manas National Park in Assam. So they were moved from Kaziranga, where the density is high, and moved to Manas National Park. And it is, and there is also a mechanism of monitoring them. So there is an electronic tag placed on these rhinos through which the conservationists are able to monitor their location and presence of these rhinos. Okay. Now, you know, one thing that really I saw when I read this news article was a lot of national parks. A lot of national parks and wildlife sanctuaries and tiger reserves and one-horned rhino reserves, all of that. Too many areas of importance that are there in Assam. So if you can see, one thing which I have done, and I have also called it as an exercise, is that I expect you to fill in all these details. Just, you know, so every time you see the notes and you see that this Assam outline is not filled, at least you will have that feeling that, hey, I should take up the map and see where these are. Dibru-Saikowa. Dibru-Saikowa is also a biosphere reserve, if you remember. Yes, and we also discussed the biosphere reserve, national park, wildlife sanctuaries. One can be part of the other. Then there is Laukowa Wildlife Sanctuary, Manas National Park. So please spend time to map all these national parks in the map of Assam. To plot all these national parks in the map of Assam. Rhinos overall, worldwide, overall, because we are not just referring to the West African rhino, because it is one subspecies that has become extinct. Overall, at a global level, IUCN calls it as vulnerable. CITES still puts it under Appendix 1, which is the highest level of protection accorded. In India also, it is under Schedule 1, which is the highest level of protection accorded to it. Any idea why people poach rhinos? Rhinos are poached. I hope you're aware of that. Rhinos are poached. What do you think is the most important catch for a... Yeah, it is for its horn. It is for its horn, absolutely. So all of you are right. Skin, yes, but more importantly, it's horn. No, I was really amazed when I looked at the price. So the rhino price, at least in the black market for the horn, it is $60,000 per pound, not even per kg. $60,000 per pound. Now, 2.2 pounds is 1 kg, which means it is approximately, let me approximate it, and it's around $150,000 per kg. How much? $150,000 per kg. Now, $150,000 is what? 1.5 lakh USD. When you, even if I apply 70 rupees as the exchange rate, it is a little more than 70. So it is 1.05 crores. Now, why will they not poach? 1.05 crores is 1 kg of the horn of the rhino. Now, compare this with gold. Gold, you know, if you generally, we measure it in 10 grams. No? 10 grams is approximately, today only I saw it, is a little less than 50,000 rupees. Okay. So 1 kg of gold, if I purchase, it is going to be 50,000, means 100 grams is 5 lakhs and 1 kg is 50 lakhs. So 1 kg of the rhino horn is more than twice 1 kg of gold. Yeah, so that's how these horns are important. And any idea why these horns are used in the first place? If it's so expensive, then they must be doing something with this, no? Medicine, yeah. And that too, Chinese medicine. The more I read about Chinese, about this extinction of species, I'm getting more curious about what they do with these horns in Chinese medicine. So one is Chinese medicine. The other thing, what they're also saying is many of them just use it as a trophy. Trophy for themselves. Now, what do you call it when someone keeps a part of wild animal as a trophy. There is a term, no, which Wildlife Protection Act bans. Do you remember? Prohibiting the display of part of wild animal. Yeah, taxidermy. Excellent, Prachi. So it's called taxidermy, which is also the true for the Barasingha. If you have seen, and they will keep the antlers as a trophy. Okay, great. So this is the exercise. I thought it will be good if you can do. Perfect. I kind of clubbed a couple of other newses related to Assam and related to biodiversity. So there is another thing. So clearly, this map, you will have 7 related to this news article and 2 more national parks related to this article. So what is important in this news? That I found some of the things important in the news. So the first thing I saw was 2 new national parks in Assam, the Hang Phat Kai.
After bathing with cold water in this cold winter, you feel invincible.
Yeah, I think someone's mic is on and muted. So what did I find interesting in this article? One was the fact that these 2 new parks are coming up. So that's why Assam as a state becomes important. So if you look at it, what are the states that I need to focus on from an environment perspective? In addition to the normal news article, I found Assam to be very important. A lot of news articles related to Assam. Madhya Pradesh is another state that you should look at it closely because of the real sheer number of tiger reserves, biosphere reserves that you have. Then that Madhya Pradesh UP border, you know, the Kane Betwa link, a lot of things is happening in Madhya Pradesh, in and around Madhya Pradesh from an environment perspective. Assam is another. Kerala is always an evergreen state. That is something that you have to anyway cover when you are looking at environment. So these 3 states, Uttarakhand is the 4th state, sorry, 4 states, I feel are important because something or the other happens related to environment in these 4 states. Okay, great. So what it also talks about is in terms of states, Assam is the 3rd state with the highest number of national parks. Madhya Pradesh is 12, followed by Andaman and Nicobar, which has 9. Okay, so that is something interesting, if you can remember. What I also felt is that this kind of refreshes us about who notifies the formation of a national park. So it's a state government after consultation with the State Board for Wildlife. Okay, so just in case there is any confusion, the national parks, even though the name is national, they are notified by the state government. Center can also do, in case you're wondering, can center do? Center can also do, but predominantly it is the state government which does that. That's the second part. And if this is the 6th and 7th national park, which are the other 5? So once again, you find similar names. You find Kaziranga, you find Manas, you find Orang, you find Dipru Saikhova. Of this, 2 of them are UNESCO World Heritage Sites. Okay. So this map of Assam, if you really take time and, you know, start marking, this is going to be a busy map with a lot of locations marked in red. And once you see it, it becomes imprinted in your mind and it becomes easy. For example, a question could be, this is a national park which is adjoining Bhutan, which is on the western side, you have West Bengal, etc. Then you will know, okay, so this national park, it cannot. So what you'll do is you'll start eliminating. You'll know, hey, this national park is towards Arunachal border, so this is gone. So western part of Assam, make, what are the things? What are the national parks which is bordering your West Bengal as well as Bhutan? So slowly you'll be able to narrow in the options very easily. Okay. So Dihang, you would have heard. Suppose I ask you, okay, which part of Assam do you think, based on your residual knowledge? Okay, so the one national park's name is Dihang Phat Kai National Park. Okay, suppose you don't look at Google, you have to choose. Okay, so I give you 4 options. Okay, so I say this as A, this as B, this as C, and this as D. Okay, I say which of this 4 area is likely to be Dihang Phat Kai National Park. Oh, wow. How come, Weber? How are you so confident D? And Abhishek and Bishanjit Singh, that was a quick answer. I'm impressed. D is the right answer indeed. D is the right answer indeed. And what was the clue that you got? Rivers are concentrated. Okay. So I didn't talk of rivers. Ah, excellent. Excellent. Dihang and Dibang. That's the clue here. Dihang Phat Kai. So Dihang, Dibang, Lohit, if you remember the three rivers, and yeah, the Lushai Patkai Hills, Patkai Boom, if you heard of it, which is eastern Himalaya. So that this is exactly what I meant. Once you plot certain national parks or some aspects on the map, you may not be able to zero in perfectly. UPSC makes life difficult, but at least you'll be able to eliminate certain options the way you guys have done it. Great, guys. Good work. Good thinking. So that is your Dihang Patkai, wherein you can identify based on your residual knowledge. But unfortunately, there is no such luck when it comes to Raimona National Park. You cannot identify it based on the location. So Raimona National Park is the one which is in this region. Yeah. But if you read about the Raimona National Parks, it talks about Baksa Tiger Reserve in West Bengal, another wildlife sanctuary in Bhutan, and Manas to the east, so on and so forth. That is one. So this is Raimona National Park at A, at location A. At location A, you have Raimona National Park. And very interesting thing, what I found about the Raimona National Park is just look at the number of forest types it has. Yeah. If I can pause here and ask you guys, did we come across any other part, state of India where I said the diversity is high because of difference in altitude? Recently, maybe 2-3 classes before, as a result of which it has, you know, huge biodiversity, a lot of flowering plants. Excellent, Naveena. Sikkim. We discussed Sikkim, if you remember. I said there are it has altitude right from 380 meters all the way up to Kanchenjunga height. And therefore, what kind of diversity is highest? Ecosystem diversity. Once ecosystem diversity is higher, what does it automatically lead to? Species diversity. Once species diversity is higher, it leads to genetic diversity. Yes, Nigar. The other part what we discussed was 100% organic and the fraternal relationship with trees called myth and all that. Good, guys. So here also we have 11 different forest types. So this kind of gives an indication, oh, which means this national park should be both at fairly at sea level or just above the sea level, and it should go all the way up, which is also understandable because it is almost bordering Bhutan. Bhutan means very high mountain. Maybe southern part of this national park could be of lower elevation, as a result of which it supports different types of forest. So what are the things that you find here? I've given some examples. I really don't expect you to remember, but it helps to know that if it is close to this Baksa Tiger Reserve, you can expect tiger to be there, and because there is tiger, you can expect prey of the tiger to also be present. Okay, some of the rivers that flow through this also becomes important, guys. Yeah, so that's on the Dihang Patkai and the Raimona National Park, the 6th and 7th National Park notified by the government of Assam recently. Coming to Cheetah Translocation Project. So once again, I think this is a good example why we should focus on MP specifically as a state. So MP's Kuno National Park is all set to receive 8 African cheetahs. So 4 males and 4 females, so that the breeding can happen. And that acts as a nuclei for you to get more tigers. So that's the typical way that they do all these translocation. This is expected to be India's first inter-country big cat relocation project. Okay, now do the cheetahs, if you look at it, cheetahs, so what distinction do we have of cheetah? There's one aspect about cheetah. No, it runs at a speed of close to 90 or 100 kilometers per hour. Yeah, fast runner, absolutely. Yeah, 90 to 100 kilometers per hour. It has been recorded to run at 90 kilometers. Some say it can even run up to a speed of 120 kilometers, but recorded is 90 kilometers per hour. 90 kilometers per hour. So that's your cheetah. Now, this cheetah is of two types. One is Asiatic cheetah, and the other is African cheetah. So what India is receiving is African, okay, not Asiatic. That's one point you should remember. Asiatic cheetah, as of now, is there in only one country, Iran. This is another thing that it will be good if you can remember. Iran has Asiatic, few remnants of Asiatic cheetah is found in Iran. And therefore, you can correlate to it, to the fact that it is classified as critically endangered. Critically endangered. In India, it was declared as extinct in 1952. So the last remnant of Asiatic cheetah in India were found in Chhattisgarh. Okay, they were found in Chhattisgarh. Now this project to relocate them. So once again, what is the funda here? You have these eight cheetah, four male, four female, and if they are able to breed and produce offspring, you will locate them to another area where, which is a natural cheetah habitat. That's the whole purpose. Very similar to the crocodile reintroduction program. Okay, this is more ambitious, maybe a little more risky, because we are not getting Asian cheetah, we are actually getting them African cheetah. So we have to make sure that our climatic and the habitat is as close to the African. So this, in this case, it's been specifically brought in from Namibia, I think. So we have to try and match some of the environmental conditions of Namibia to the Kuno National, to some of the parts of India. And we will see which are the locations which are ideal for, ideal as cheetah habitat. Okay. Yeah, so once again, you keep on hearing the same thing, you know, sites, appendix one. So here, there is one important thing. The Asiatic cheetah is classified as critically endangered. Okay. But if you take cheetah as a whole means both Asiatic and African, it comes as vulnerable. So just be cautious in case they try to confuse you. So overall, cheetah is considered as vulnerable because there are good population of African cheetah. When you come specifically to Asiatic cheetah, they become critically endangered. Okay. Now, I want to ask you one thing. So whenever you think about cheetah, yeah, and you must have seen in Discovery or National Geographic about cheetah hunting and all. Can someone describe me how that scene looks like? I mean, not that it is chasing a deer, I'm not asking you to describe that scene. How does the habitat look like? Any keywords that you want to tell in the habitat? For example, I'm just giving an example, snow-clad mountain or tall trees or rivers. Grassland, okay. Dry grassland, superb, absolutely. So Vaibhav kind of started it and Abhishek completed it. It is tropical grassland, means the cheetah. Snow leopard is different. I'm talking specifically about both the African and the Asiatic cheetah. It is dry grassland, as Abhishek says, which is nothing but the tropical grassland. So whenever you see a cheetah, now you will always find that it is running behind a prey in an open land. Do you agree? How many times have you seen a cheetah where you find it in a thick forest, like a tropical evergreen forest? Very rare, if at all there is any. You will either find it under the tropical grassland or a savanna grassland where there will be a lot of grasslands and in between there will be a tree. Then another 200, 300 or 400 or 1 kilometer, there is only grassland, then there is another tree. So that kind of grassland is called as the savanna type of biome, which we will discuss. Okay, good guys. Which means this also tells that MP's Kuno National Park is not like your is not going to be like your Silent Valley or Nilgiri Reserve, because those are all thickly forested areas, whereas Kuno National Park, and it is, you know, if you look at it, it is close to or part of the Chambal region or near the Chambal region. Yeah. So Chambal, if you have seen in when it comes to land degradation, it's actually ravines or badland. So an area which is close to ravine or badland suddenly cannot be tropical forest anyways. Therefore, it's a grassland. So you can look at all these, you know, connect all these dots so that you are sure about what a Kuno National Park looks like. So please take the map once again. You'll find that Kuno National Park is like the northernmost part of Madhya Pradesh, somewhat close to Jhansi in UP, if you understand what I'm saying. Yeah. 600 kilometers from Kanha National Park, is it? Okay. So I saw it in the map and the closest I could relate was it is to the west of Jhansi, if you can understand. Jhansi is in UP, but if you go to the west of Jhansi, you will come to MP. So you know the map of MP, it's in the top part of MP. Okay, great. Kuno River flows through the national park. So this is also fine. Oh, Chambal, I have mentioned it here. Good. Anything else here? We have looked at African, we have looked at Asiatic, Iran, vulnerable, critically endangered. Yeah, I think more or less we've covered. Okay, we have covered. So sticking to the cat family, the next news article is about an accreditation. You must have heard of this term. Which sector do we hear this term often? Any idea? Which sector? Accreditation. Conservation Assured Tiger Standards. Which sector? Yeah, university and education. Exactly. You actually, you know, this accredited university, which is actually that the university is trying to promote its credential. So why does it say that this is a nationally accredited university? To convince the potential students that this is a great place to study, where we have a great recognition, great faculty. That is why we got the accreditation. Okay, so that's right. So we broadly find this in a lot of educational institutes. Similar kind of accreditation has been done for tiger reserves. Now, why would an international organization do accreditation? So that it is convinced that the management practices followed in these tiger reserves will help in tiger conservation. Is the funda clear? Any accreditation, the purpose is they are putting their stamp of approval, saying that the process these guys are following, whatever it be, education, health, industry, anything else, whenever there is a national accreditation, it tells that the processes that you are following will result to the fruitful outcome. In this case, the fruitful outcome is the conservation of tiger. Okay. So the name of the accreditation is Conservation Assured Tiger Standards. So this is not L or I, this is just this, you know, in your keyboard, you have this line. So Conservation Assured Tiger Standards. Okay. Now, which are those 14 tiger reserves that also I have mentioned? Which are those 14 tiger? So what does this mean? This means that some third party has come, looked at a lot of tiger reserves. In that, they have found that in these 14 tiger reserves, the management will eventually lead to successful tiger conservation. So this will give the government also the confidence that out of the 51 tiger reserve, 14 tiger reserves are already accredited as Conservation Assured Tiger Standards. Therefore, it will give a push to the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change that why not do it for the entire 51. So this becomes a very systematic, methodical, internationally accepted way of tiger conservation, because you're bringing in a well-established process. Needless to say, I expect you to once again pick up the map and see some of these tiger reserves, because once you start seeing the national parks, the same national park will be mentioned in a different context. For example, see, even in today's class itself, we are hearing Manas and Kaziranga for the third time. Yeah, well, we saw about the Indian Rhino Vision. Then we talked about this, the two new national parks introduced in Assam. Now we are talking about the tiger reserves. Then we may talk about biosphere reserves, so on and so forth. Okay, so please do map these on the India map so that it becomes easy for you. Okay, guys. The next article is also about tiger, Valmiki Tiger Reserve. So in Valmiki Tiger Reserve, the news is about the tiger reserve, but the news is not about the tiger. The news is about vulture. Okay. So vulture is also one of the critically endangered species, especially the Indian varieties. And in Valmiki Tiger Reserve, they have spotted more than 150 vultures. So it has given them a lot of hope. And the location, you know, just for you to make it easy for you, I've even said it is the only tiger reserve in Bihar. So which part of Bihar do you think it is going to be? It is going to be in the Bihar-Nepal border. So one easy thing for you to remember is just go across the Nepal border, you will find three tiger reserves. You start from Uttarakhand, Jim Corbett, you come a little towards Uttar Pradesh, you will find Dudhwa National Park and Tiger Reserve. You go more towards to the eastern part, which is Bihar, you will find Valmiki Tiger Reserve. Are you able to understand Uttarakhand, UP and Bihar, the three tiger reserves along the India-Nepal border? Okay, and that's why these are in the Tarai region. Okay. Now, so I mentioned it also. Good. So it's near the Nepal border. Forests of this tiger reserve have a combination of Bhabar and Terai tracts. So in geography, you must have studied Bhabar. Bhabar. What do you mean by Bhabar here? Means how do you describe a Bhabar? Soil, yes, it's a type of soil. If you look at it from a, let me say, from a cross-section point of view, so that Bhabar, Khadar, Bhangar, everything we discuss at one go very quickly. If you take a cross-section, yeah, actually boulders, you're right, Bhabar. So we'll quickly discuss this. I hope you are able to visualize the picture that I'm drawing here. And this can be used for geography also, to make the fundal a little clear. Suppose if this is your Himalaya, yeah, and this is your Bhabar, Terai, Bhangar. So I'm not sure if I'm able to explain this to you. See this as a cross section. Can you see this as a cross section? Which means this is your Himalaya. Yeah. The foothills of the Himalaya is at the foothills of the Himalaya is what you have the Bhabar, which is boulders, big pebbles. Yeah. In fact, boulders would be a better way. Then after this region, you have what is called as the Terai region. Terai region. And after Terai, you have the Bhangar, and after Bhangar, so if this is the river, let's say, are you able to understand this is a cross section, huh? Neither, which is like a side view, means if you look at it from a position where Himalayas is to your left, means you're looking at Uttar Pradesh, let's say standing in Rajasthan. I don't know if I'm able to explain this to you. So you'll see Himalayas to your left. Then you'll see there is Bhabar, then there is Terai, then there is Bhangar, and then there is Khadar. Khadar and Bhangar. So these are the ones which are fine alluvium. Alluvial soil, which is very fertile. And needless to say, it is bound to be fertile because it is part of the floodplains. So as you move away from it, you have Bhangar, in which you also, you know, you have in Hindi, you call it as the Kankar, yeah, which is made up of limestone. So you have Bhangar, Khadar, Bhangar. Then you have the Terai region. Terai region is the place where they say that the rivers go underground and they emerge. This is your Terai region. Bhabar. Bhabar is just the foothills of Himalayas. Okay. So why I kind of just drew this is also another way for you to identify where it is. The moment it says it is in Bhabar and Terai, you know for sure it is not very far from the foothills of Himalayas. That's the other logic why I said, we should remember it geographically. Okay, Bhabar and Terai tracts. So vulture for a very long time. So I've highlighted certain words. I've mentioned some of these words in italics. I'll tell why they are. So obviously I see a new organization or an entity. So one organization is this Integrated Development of Wildlife Habitats. Now, who are they? It is an ongoing centrally sponsored scheme. Earlier, it was called as Assistance for the Development of National Parks and Sanctuaries. So apparently, for any conservation, approval is granted by the Integrated Development of Wildlife Habitats. So it's a government scheme where the state and the union territories have to seek funds from them in order to implement some of the conservation programs, especially for the critically endangered species. Okay, so in case you've not come across this scheme or organization, you may just want to take note. Integrated Development of Wildlife Habitat. So that is one part. Now a little bit more about vulture and the diclofenac itself, you know, because I have deliberately kept this statement from the news, which says the government will have to ensure that there is no use of diclofenac in the 10 kilometer radius of the vulture safe zone. From 2000 onwards, the vulture population in India started declining rapidly. So rapidly that it alarmed the conservationist. A, it was declining. B, it was not sure what was the reason. Then it took a lot of research to understand what had caused the decline in the vulture population, and the culprit was zeroed in to this chemical called as diclofenac. So diclofenac, in simple language, is a painkiller. In medical language, it is called as a non-steroid anti-inflammatory drug, sometimes abbreviated as NSAID. Non-steroid anti-inflammatory drug used for cattle. So it is one of the most popular medicine used by veterinarians to treat pain in the cattle or any grazing population. So what happened was, this remains in the tissues of the cattle even after it is dead, which means you could say this, what is the phenomena that is actually happening is bioaccumulation. Do you agree? The doctor gave it the medicine, it goes into its bloodstream, it cures the pain, but it just becomes part of the tissue. So there is bioaccumulation. Now from there, vultures are eating the carcasses. And in this case, because we have gone one tropic level higher, what is happening here? The bioaccumulation in the cattle that was there in the cattle is now becoming a biomagnification in the case of a vulture. If you remember the difference between these two, because it has gone one tropic level above, what happens to the concentration of the poison? The concentration of the poison increases. There is a biomagnification. And almost all, 99% of the vultures died due to one symptom. And that symptom was failure of the kidneys. So this is one aspect about this italics word called diclofenac. Now comes your status. So it is classified as critically endangered. For sure, you know, vulture is always identified as critically endangered species for a long time under IUCN. And species like vulture, now India has 9 species of vulture, and species like vulture, eagle, falcon, which are birds of prey, they're also called as raptors. In case you're hearing this term for the first time, raptors are birds of prey. Okay. Now vulture becomes important in the Indian context specifically because overall, in general, the majority of the population does not eat cattle meat. Therefore, when the cattle die or they are about to die, of course, in few cases they are turned to slaughterhouse, but in few cases they are not. So the cattle dies sometimes, or many times when it is not buried, it is left out in the open. So when it is left out in the open, before it rots and smells, it is a vulture that comes and does the role of cleaning up the carcasses. Okay, so that's why a vulture becomes all the more important in any country which does not consume cattle meat. Okay, so that's the logic, and that's why it is a little more important in India than in countries where beef or cattle meat may be consumed. Okay, so that's on the vulture conservation. But please do read these articles themselves. I pick up the important points from the news article, but I also encourage you to read them so that you feel a little better. The next article is about a topic which we have discussed earlier, but it requires repetition because everywhere, you know, you keep hearing this news. So 20th May was a World Bee Day. So every year we have World Bee Day. Apparently it is based on one of the earliest beekeepers in the history. He lived somewhere in the 20th century. So it was his birthday, and 20th May becomes the World Bee Day. And this year, theme, and FAO is the apex organization which is driving efforts for improving the population of bees. So this becomes important. Sometimes they say, you know, be engaged, build back better for bees. So this is a theme for FAO, yeah, not for IUCN, not for UNEP, not for WWF, but for FAO, because sometimes these organizations can be confusing. Unless we know it specifically, it will be difficult to write the right answer. So FAO has started off with this theme, and we have discussed long back about both the Albert Einstein comment and as well as the importance of bees as pollinators. So pollinators, so the key point here is the term pollinator species, invertebrate. Invertebrate means one that do not have the backbone. Okay. Face extinction across the world according to, okay. So when you look at pollinators, So pollination is what? In simple language, pollination is nothing but reproduction in plants. I'm not saying this is 100% accurate, but reproduction in plants. So pollination in plants can be of two types. One is self-pollination. Self-pollination is what? The pollens are moved from the male reproductive organization called anther to the female reproductive organization called as the stigma. So in the same flower, if you look at a flower, you can actually look at the anther and the stigma very clearly. And the pollen moves from anther to stigma. It is called a self-pollination. So there are no agents of pollination. There are no agents of pollination required. Okay, let me draw here. So you have pollination. So let's say you have two types, self-pollination and cross-pollination. So cross-pollination, obviously you need agents. So agents could be either biotic or they could be abiotic. See, abiotic means what? It could be wind, it could be water. Biotic means primarily animals. Yeah, so animals in this, it could be, let me put it this way, vertebrates. Yeah, and invertebrates. So invertebrates example is butterfly, for example, and bees. Vertebrate is pretty much a lot of things, like the bird species, even mammals can cause pollination. Yeah, you're able to understand this. Self and cross. Self, I told, from anther it moves to stigma without any additional support. So that is self-pollination. Cross-pollination is biotic, abiotic. Abiotic, wind and water. But a lot of pollination happens by these guys, butterflies and bees. Okay. So, yeah, I think that's a high level picture of what a pollination is all about. Now, if you read the news, it will be a little easy for us to understand. We've discussed this. Wind, water. So some facts, 90% of the world's flowering plant entirely depend on animal pollination, and 75% of the food crops also depend on pollination. That's why they say cross pollination. Yeah. Now, if I were to ask you, between the self-pollination and cross-pollination, which one do you think has a greater chance of increasing the biodiversity? It's going to be cross, right? Absolutely. It's going to be cross-pollination, because self-pollination is pretty much the same plant, same species, same plant. Whereas cross-pollination, it may go and pollinate with a species, same species, maybe slightly different subspecies. So what does it do? It increases the species diversity. And by default, it increases the genetic diversity. And by default, it improves the sustainability of the ecosystem, because more the diversity, more is the probability of the ecosystems to survive intense bouts of natural selection. Okay, good guys. Causes of decline, I think it's somewhat similar. I want you to remember, though I have not quoted the news article, the European Union has banned a lot of pesticides which are thought to impact the population of bees. Yeah. So there's one particular chemical item, I'm not able to recollect that. That was the one which was found to be the killer for the bees. And once the bees were starting to die in large number, it really created a lot of concern. So that particular chemical item was banned by the European Union. And when it comes to India, interestingly, has something like 700 bee species, of which 40 is endemic. So we do have our own share of bee species. And as you guys had rightly said, because of cross-pollination, the diversity increases. So when the diversity increases, what are we doing? It is not just the abundance, but also the variety and quality. Okay, so to that extent, it helps in making the food web because food web is a more practical concept rather than the food chain. So it helps in making the food web more robust, yeah, and less susceptible to bouts of natural selection. That's why this concern on bees, especially overall the invertebrate pollinators is a cause of concern. In this, the key thing that you need to understand is the whole initiative is being driven by Food and Agriculture Organization, because bees means related to food production. That's why you're not seeing some of the traditional conservation organizations like IUCN or WWF or UNEP coming into this picture here. That's how you can relate and remember well. Okay, great. Recently, the Uttarakhand government came that it will start valuating, means a proper monetary valuation of its environmental resource, so much so that they said that we will start formally introducing the concept of gross environment product, just as we do gross domestic product. So we saw Sikkim doing something 100% organic, fraternal relationship with trees, etc. Now you have another mountainous state which talks about having a gross environmental product along the lines of gross domestic product. They have not implemented, they have just said this. Okay. So what is it that they are going to do? So what they have claimed is, we will assign a monetary value to four critical natural sources: air, water, forest, and soil. So based on the fresh air that they generate, some monetary value will be assigned. Based on the fresh water that comes out of Uttarakhand, which is practically going to be the Ganges River system, I mean the origin of the Ganges River system and some of the other systems that originate in Uttarakhand, we will be able to assign a monetary value. This clearly, you know, has brought in a lot of attention to a fact which has been attempted earlier also, if not in India, at a world level. Few classes before, we looked at the concept of ecosystem services. If you remember, there was a slide which was titled The Importance of Biodiversity. In that, I would have given three kind of subparts: ecosystem services, biological resource of economic importance, and then recreation value. Under ecosystem resources, if you remember, there was a couple of subpoints. I talked about nutrient recycling, fresh air, clean water, medicinal value, soil nutrients. All these are ecosystem services which makes it possible for humans and the other species to survive. Okay, so one thing that's a key takeaway for you from this article or from this newspaper item is that the gross environmental product is synonymous to the concept of ecosystem services, or let me say, is synonymous to the concept of monetizing ecosystem services. I think you can remember it like this: gross environmental product is same as or is similar to monetizing the ecosystem services. That's what they are saying. If you read between the lines, though they have not used the word ecosystem services, but this article kind of nicely tries to explore the similarity between both the concepts. So this is ecosystem services for you. And more than 20 years back, this economist, Constanza, along with a lot of his colleagues, they were able to prove, they were able to evaluate the ecosystem services globally, means the total value of fresh air, soil, clean water, rivers on which we built the dams, forest that gives us multiple resources, be it timber, non-timber forest producers, the role of forest in the various nutrient cycle, which we will discuss, oxygen cycle, water cycle, etc. So they added a monetary value to all, and the result may not be a shocker actually, because people always felt that the ecosystem services are really high, but when they started putting a monetary value, what is important is the value of ecosystem services is about twice as much as that of the global GDP. Global GDP, imagine, the global GDP itself will be in few trillions of dollars, few hundreds of trillions of dollars. This is twice as that of the GDP. So important is the concept of ecosystem services. So in my view, so this article kind of casts some doubt, saying this looks like a political gimmick and, you know, the details are not out. But I am somewhat upbeat about this whole concept, because for the first time, we are beginning to see the monetary value of ecological resources. Because as human beings, unless we put a, you know, cost tag, it becomes very difficult for us to compare. So what this gross economic environmental product will do is, once you have value for fresh air, fresh water, forest, and soil, okay? Now imagine, due to pollution, the quality of air comes down. So let's say they say they are able to have a dollar value for fresh air. Fresh air means, you may say, but sir, how will they find fresh air possible? What they may do, I don't know. If I were there, what I'll do is, I'll look at the air quality index in all major cities and towns of Uttarakhand and say, if the air quality index is less than 50, I'll give it something like 100. If the air quality index is, let's say, between 50 to 200, I will give it a value of 50. I'm just giving an example. Soil also, I'll give it. If it is a fertile soil of this category, then some number. Now, as a state of Uttarakhand, I'll have a GDP. So I'll have two parameters to monitor. So the first parameter what I monitor is GDP. I find that the GDP is increasing, but if I find the GDP is decreasing, I know for sure that I need to improve the GDP. In other words, it becomes very easy for us to correlate the relationship between GDP and GDP and understand whether the cost of economic development comes at the expense of environmental protection. Are you broadly able to understand? And that's why this para here becomes important. Yeah, it will help us in understand if development is happening at the cost of ecology and how do we maintain a balance between both. Okay. Yeah, I think it is more about the same concept, especially Uttarakhand. Yeah, the other thing that the article argues is Uttarakhand, the ecosystem services is extremely important, because all the ecological ecosystem services of Uttarakhand is somewhat used by Uttar Pradesh, you know, which is the most populous state of India, because, you know, fresh water, some of the biological resources that comes along with the water, maybe some of the hydroelectric projects that are there in Uttarakhand, which supplies electricity to Uttar Pradesh and all that. Therefore, Uttarakhand becomes an important state for ecosystem services, because it is sharing these ecosystem services with Uttar Pradesh. Nice. So now, after discussing a lot of topics in Assam, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Sikkim, Madhya Pradesh, let's now move to a completely different type of biome, Gujarat. Yeah, in that specifically a grassland. And that grassland, name of that grassland is Banni grassland. No, thank you, Bishanjit Singh. I think it's a useful information. Thank you. I'm sure others have also benefited out of this. So it's good. I think some of you have, you know, Bishanjit Singh has a master's in, I'm sorry if I'm wrong, but was it botany or microbiology, one of them. And he's also pursuing or thinking of pursuing his PhD. Oh, genetics, I'm sorry. Okay. So good. So please, keep coming such topics if you come across, which is relevant to what I'm discussing. It obviously enriches the relation, enriches the discussion. Yeah, especially in an online class kind of a thing where it is a monologue. And I have no clue how many of you are actually, you know, watching it or listening to it. So this kind of two-way conversation helps patiently. I appreciate that. Thank you. Okay. So National Green Tribunal ordered that all encroachments should be removed from Gujarat Banni grassland within 6 months. Okay. So a lot of things we have already discussed about NGT. Okay. So this is... The good thing is you don't have to study about NGT fresh. This is done. But what we have not really studied is Banni grassland. So let's try to understand what is Banni grassland and what is its importance in the in the overall scheme of things for people over there. Okay. So Let's look at the map actually here. Yeah, so this is a map of Gujarat. And you're able to see this green patch over here. So this is your Banni grassland. And the Banni grassland is part of what? It is actually a part of Greater Run of Kutch. Yeah. Now, is Greater Run of Kutch also a protected area? Any idea? Is Greater Run of Kutch also a protected idea, protected area? Or Run of Kutch is a protected area? It is, yes, it is one of the 18 biosphere reserves, if you remember. Yeah, exactly. It's a biosphere reserve. Good, Naveena. And the distinction is, it is the largest biosphere reserve in terms of area. Go back to the respective slide, you will find that I would have mentioned something like 10,000 square kilometers. So this is the largest biosphere reserve of India. Now, in this map, if you look at it, this is your Banni grassland, comes in the Kutch region. So you have the little run of Kutch here. And you have this controversial Sir Creek also here. Yeah, a lot of information on this map that way. So you have the Sir Creek here. And you have the international boundary. That's why it is like straight line. Yeah. And what are the other things that we are able to see? We are able to see this Gir and Girnar. So this is your Asiatic lion sanctuary over here. And so this is Banni grassland. Now let's look at what this grassland is. What are the key characteristics of this grassland? And what are the things necessary for us from an prelims point of view? Okay. So the first thing that we get to know is the pastoral community here, they're called the Maldharis. So they are the ones who have petitioned before the NGT, and the NGT has given its verdict in favor of Maldharis. Okay. And what kind of grassland it is going to be? It is, you know, Banni grassland, you know, the Tropic of Cancer is going very close to it. So it is going to be a tropical grassland. Tropical grassland is also savanna type, shrub savanna type. Okay, so this is the first one. Area, not so important, but just an order of magnitude, it helps. 45% of pasture in Gujarat, this is fine. This point is a little important to look at it. Why is this important? This NGT order is in tune with the Forest Rights Act 2006. So this is an excellent live example of the Forest Rights Act getting actually implemented. Why? Because under Forest Rights Act, they have the right to conserve the community forest in the area granted to them. Okay, so the encroachments that were happening in those areas, as per Forest Rights Act, what happened? They, anyone who, because they become the owners, no? Even though not as title deeds or something, but they become owners because they have historically been staying there. Okay. So this point on the NGT quoting the Forest Rights Act while giving its verdict is important because it links to another act related to forest. And it is also a reserve forest. Please go back to your biodiversity slide where we touched about the reserve forest, protected forest, the kind of permission that is required for reserve forest and all. Okay. And very interesting thing, I mentioned it as the fifth point. The Wildlife Institute of India has identified this grassland reserve as one of the last remaining habitats of cheetah and possible reintroduction site for species. I believe this is an extremely important statement, especially in the context that MP's Kuno National Park is receiving African cheetah. Maybe once they settle well there. By the way, this Kuno National Park, it's mentioned in the slide, I have not verbalized it. The reason for delay in the transfer of the cheetahs from Africa to India is because we are yet to get approval from CITES, the Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species of Flora and Fauna, and also COVID. Both of them caused it a delay, but people are saying that we expect it by December, January. So December, January, we'll have these African tigers translocated to the Kuno National Park. Okay, so now connect the dots. We are talking of cheetah, yeah? And we saw that Kuno National Park, what was it? It was also a grassland. And what is Banni? Banni is also grassland. So cheetah, tropical grassland, Banni, Kuno National Park, Asiatic cheetah, African cheetah, all of them are the interrelated terms that you should remember. Okay. Yeah. The other part about the Banni grassland is buffalo. Because whenever you have grassland, whom do you find? You find the pastoral community. Do you agree? Not just in India, but even worldwide. Pampas, steppes, prairie, all of them, you'll find pastoral agriculture. So here, bunny buffalo is an endemic species. It's the only species which people in this part of India say can survive the harsh summers and the harsh weather for majority of the period. And it is a major source of income for these pastoralists also. It is said that it can give up to 12 to 18 liters of milk. Okay. What is also important about bunny is that even though this is a kind of a, you know, as many of you said, tropical or savanna type grassland, during monsoon, because some of them, the areas is even below the sea level, they also become wetlands. So this is interesting. So it is part grassland, part wetland during monsoon. During the dry season and in the winter, it is full grassland. Okay. So I believe they take you to bunny grassland as part of your, they at least take you to Gujarat, many places in Gujarat as part of your Bharat Darshan. Okay. So if you want to know more about bunny, I suggest you clear this examination and as part of Bharat Darshan, go to these places and you tell me more information which I have left out. Because I saw some of my students posting pictures about this Dholavira. So Dholavira is also somewhere here, by the way. There is a huge lake here and there is Dholavira site here, yeah, which is your Indus Valley site. So all of this comes in this area. So it seems to be a very, very important area from a historical heritage, world heritage, biodiversity, everything, and international relations also. If I take this point, it's from an international relations also. Okay, good guys. yeah, there was this news article about blue whale. I'm sorry, I forgot to copy the link, but I think blue whale is something which we all know, you know, considered the largest animal on planet Earth. It can go all the way up to 200 tons. 100 tons is a normal fully full-sized blue whale. Some of it goes all the way up to 200 tons. And they have also been poached, or hunting is quite rampant. Initially, it was in the Nordic countries, Norway, Sweden, Finland, some of Denmark, some of those countries. And in the Asia side, it was Japan. So Japan is one major country which still continues to do commercial whaling despite we having an international organization called International Whaling Commission. Have I mentioned it? Yeah, this one. Yeah, so there is this organization called International Whaling Commission, which is considered as one of the first international treaty related to environment way back in 1956. Okay, and 88 member countries, which is good. And India is also a part of it. Once again, conservation status becomes important. What does site say? What does... I have not mentioned IUCN, sorry. Please do check up the IUCN status, but sites and the Wildlife Protection Act, I have mentioned it. Now, some international conventions, I'm really putting this under your self-study because I really don't think I'll be able to add much value adding more points to it. But whenever you are looking at international organizations, please remember things like this. Who is the organization? What kind of organization it is. For example, this is international agreement between governments. So this is an example of intergovernmental. Intergovernmental, part of United Nations, and it's truly global. Imagine, it's all 183 means it can compete with United Nations actually. So 183 are parts of the sites, are also called as the Washington Convention, and India is also a party to it. Then there is this program called MIKE, Monitoring of Illegal Killing of Elephants. And when we discussed Project Elephant, I also mentioned that MIKE is being implemented as part of Project Elephant. And elephants are killed for their ivories, correct? Tusks, which once again fetch very high a price in the market, in the black market. Traffic. So science is intergovernmental, fully intergovernmental, whereas traffic is fully NGO. Means it's a private sector initiative or a non-government organization initiative, but both are common in their objective, which is focusing on wildlife trade, Now, one thing I want you to also remember, in addition to this, whether it is intergovernmental or not, whether it is a part of UN, whether India is a part. So these are the three things that you need to study: intergovernmental or NGO, whether it is part of UN, whether it is India is a part, And also fourth one, whether it is legally binding or not. I have not mentioned all of this, but whenever you come across an organization, add four points to it. Type, whether it is NGO, intergovernmental, part of UN or not, whether India is a part, whether it is legally binding. These four means that's all. Very rarely questions come in international organizations beyond these four dimensions. Okay. So this is about sites. Now coming to, I forgot to add this point. So if you look at the language of sites, no, what does it say? It aims to ensure that international trade in specimens of wild animals and plants do not threaten their survival. It's very interesting. In UPSC, if you get an option that sites prohibits trade. Yeah, I'll repeat it, Bhavna. In UPSC generally, if you come across any organization, international organization, where they say sites prohibits international trade, you know, if you don't know, but if you have a good knowledge base overall, you'll be very tempted to agree with the statement. Do you agree? Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species, obviously they'll be prohibiting, no, because we want to save them. But it is not that simple. Why? Because they also understand that sometimes it is really impossible to completely prohibit. So what you do is, whenever you see the word prohibit, no, whenever you see the word prohibit, read through that option once again. Please read through that option once again, because prohibit is called as an absolute statement. Now, this is one of the tricks of the prelims also. I don't really believe in tricks for prelims because it doesn't work all the time. But any absolute statement, you can be a little careful. Yeah, sometimes absolute statement is also true. But generally, absolute statement means read that statement again. Instead, if you find a word which is more moderate means what? Regulate. This is more likely to be correct as compared to the word prohibit, which is like exclusive, means no chance, it prohibits. But prohibit kind of fits very well to sites, no? Because that is why this organization has been formed in the first place. But if you read at the fine print, what is it saying? To ensure that international trade in specimens of wild animals and plants does not threaten their survival. So the hidden meaning of this, if I may use the word, it is talking about sustainable use. That's the key word. How do you do sustainable use? You regulate, you place law, but you do not prohibit. A, because it is not practically possible. B, sometimes it may not be feasible also. It may not be feasible also. For example, I'll tell you, when this cheetah translocation from Africa to India, yeah, India is going to pay for it. So you are getting a wild animal and you are paying. In that case, that technically becomes international trade, no? Because there is a movement of goods, in this case, live goods, and there is a monetary transaction, so it's a trade. But can you stop that? No, because the objective of the trade is to actually increase the population of cheetah beyond Africa and into India. So that cheetah transfer, which we just discussed at the start of this class, now read this once again. International trade in specimens of wild animals or wild animals themselves does not threaten their survival. Does the transfer of 8 cheetah from Africa to the India, does it threaten the species cheetah? No, because the whole purpose is conservation. And therefore, it is approved under sites. Even though we've not got the approval, but in principle, we are not doing anything wrong in that. Okay. Yeah, so the four things that I said, Bhavna, is quite absent-minded. Sometimes I forget. So let me try. First thing is the type of organization, whether it is between government or NGO or a combination. It can be a combination also. Okay. The second thing I said was whether it is a part of UN or outside UN. Sometimes, very rarely, something can be intergovernmental, but it need not be part of UN. It need not be part of UN. For example, there may be 4 or 5 governments. There is a organization called SAVEN, South Asian. Yeah, so it is about 8 South Asian countries. So that is intergovernmental, but it is not UN. Okay, so whether it, the first one is whether it is intergovernmental or NGO. Second is whether a part of UN or not. Third, whether India is a part of that convention or the treaty or the protocol. And fourth is whether it is legally binding. These four dimensions is all that you need to understand from a international organizations for environment perspective. Okay. So traffic, so my eyes will very quickly move through those four filters. Maybe I don't find answer in this PPT, but I hope you can do it after the class. So whether this is an NGO or not, it is an NGO. It is not an, so clearly it mentions non-government organization. Okay. Now, even if you look at the mission here, see the mission statement is ensure that the trade in wild plant and animals is not a threat, which means you do it. So, but you do it in a way which is sustainable. Okay. Coalition Against Wildlife Trafficking. So this organization I separately pulled because this is one unique organization which has all governments, non-governments and industry representatives. So everyone is there. Neither it is fully NGO nor it is fully intergovernmental. It's a combination of all. SAVIN. So SAVIN is an example where it is intergovernmental but not a part of UN. What is it? South Asian Wildlife Enforcement Network. South Asian Wildlife Enforcement Network. 8 South Asian countries. And this is an example of intergovernmental, but not a part of UN. And India is a part of this. Okay. So please try to fill the 4 points for all these 5, 6 or any other organizations that you keep coming in future so that you know the lens or the prism through which you have to look at these organizations. Convention WWF. I mean, we are not referring to the wrestling one here. I hope you understand that. So it is the worldwide fund for nature. You know, it is that emblem which has the panda sticking out. So we are referring to that WWF. It is one of the leading non-governmental organization at a global level, focusing on conservation research and restoration of environment. CMS, Convention on Conservation of Migratory Species, also called as Bonn Convention. You have some points here. Part of UN, only global convention specialized on conservation of migratory species, and all the migratory species which are threatened with extinction, they are put under Appendix 1. So you find the same thing here, Appendix 1 here, Appendix 1 insights, Wildlife Protection Act, our Wildlife Protection Act, Schedule 1, somewhere you will find that all of them are given similar importance both in India and abroad, generally. Okay, so if you know for one, most probably it will be the same Appendix 1 or Schedule 1 on the other also. Okay. One thing that I want you to remember of migratory species, no? Generally when we think of migratory species, we always think of birds, but not necessary. Olive ridley turtles, for nesting alone they come, Gahir Mata. Okay, so that's a migratory species. Yeah, fishes can be migratory species. Okay, so avian species, birds anyway are migratory. Amphibians can be migratory, reptiles can be migratory, fishes can be migratory, mammals can be migratory. So I want you to remember that this species, not this conservation organization is not just for birds, it is for all. That's why it's mentioned here, aquatic, avian, migratory species, terrestrial, aquatic, avian, migratory species. So all three modes, land, water, air, as long as anything migrates, it comes under the category of CMS. International Whaling Organization, the reason why I put this was, it is one of the first international environmental legislation way back in 1946. So way back in 1946, people understand that the way at which the whales are being hunted down, it is not sustainable. And therefore, this regulation came. So this is once again intergovernmental. It is mentioned here, no? Intergovernmental. Once again, an intergovernmental organization which has some 88 members. Okay. So that's on the International Whaling Organization. Okay. So that brings us to the end of a big, big portion called as biodiversity. And I still would like to take the remaining 10-15 minutes of your time because we are running a little short in terms of number of classes. Environment alone, we have done 19 and I expect easily 22 classes of environment. So 22 means approximately 44 hours, or even if you less a little bit the first class, it's 42 hours. So I'm reasonably satisfied that we've done a decent treatment of environment, both from static and current affairs point of view. And I hope it keeps you in good stead, both for prelims as well as mains. Other than that, maybe you can just take a 2 minutes break. If anyone has any specific queries on maybe environment or how is the preparation overall going for all of you? Because, you know, based on my experience as a faculty in a coaching institute, I'll tell you one insight that I gained. December, January, is the time when the aspirant himself or herself knows whether he's going to make it or not, as in whether am I really there for the next year or not. Yeah. So this is a real time for you to reflect and constantly boost your morale, come what may. Yeah. So one thing that really, at least in my preparation time, I was in Delhi when I was preparing for my first three attempts. So winter means it was a serious, winter itself was very depressing for me, because I've always been in Chennai and somewhat like Goa, Bombay, some of the coastal areas always. So winter I could never really get used to. And unfortunately, all the mains exam I wrote was from Delhi in the month of, in those days, it used to be October and November first week. So winter was not bad that way. It was not bad, but still November itself, I used to find it very difficult to manage in winter. Okay. So one thing you guys can do is to maybe pursue some hobby if you have one. Yeah, for example, reading could be one hobby, gardening could be one. I know some of you are avid sports person and go to gym regularly. That can be an excellent hobby. So please do pursue your hobby, whatever it is, and make sure your hobby acts as a, what should I say, acts as a morale booster. Whenever the morale is down, the hobby acts as a morale booster. So in this context, you know, I just wanted to share with you, you know, picture of a person in case, do you know this guy? Anyone who knows this gentleman over here, who is giving a lecture? Known? Okay, I'll share another picture. Maybe if you can. Yeah, this is a close-up of this person. Any guesses? Okay, sorry for the pun, but so this is Abhishek, you know, one of the person who's there on the call. He's also a civil service aspirant. So I was really happy when he shared that he's been called in his college to to give a presentation on India's heritage. Yeah. So such things keeps you a little motivated. Yeah. I'll be equally happy if someone tells me. Yeah, I don't know, it could be Harsh or it could be Bishanjit Singh. Someone tells me that, you know, today I was able to do, I don't know, maybe 20 push-ups at one go or something, or 50 squats at one go or something. Go for these small kinds of achievement that will really help you in the long run to not just beat winter, but also to keep yourself motivated. So Abhishek, you know, just taking 1 minute of everyone's time, can you tell what was this about and, you know, what did you really talk about? Maybe Abhishek, if it's possible for you to unmute and speak for a minute. You're there, Abhishek. Let me first check if you're there on the call still. Yeah, you seem to be there with both video and audio off. No problem. I think let him come back. We will ask.
Yeah, I'm actually in the study hall, so I have to come out.
Oh, I'm sorry. So no problem.
It's okay, sir. I'm outside right now.
Okay. Sorry for the trouble. But I was quite impressed with this. So congratulations to you, Abhishek. You know, I'm sure others so motivated. If you can, you know, since there is some background noise, if you can maybe just spend about a minute to tell what this lecture to your alma mater was and, you know, how did you feel about this experience?
So actually, I used to run an NGO that used to engage with common school students. We used to teach them every week.
Uh-huh.
There's this scheme called as National Means Come Merit Scholarship Scheme, whereby if a 8th class, 7th class going government school underprivileged kid clears the exam, uh-huh, until the age of 19 or 18, whenever he completes his 12th grade, he will be given 500 rupees per month.
Okay.
So we were teaching children, and almost about 350 to 400 children, we could actually make them clear the exam so that their financial future is secure with respect to education.
Okay.
So okay. These are the kind of initiatives that I was doing primarily in college day. So suddenly last week I get a call from college saying that, you know, we want you as a guest, telling the first years who are just inducted into the college about how to contribute positively back to society while still a student. So, and they also said that, you know, you can talk about whatever history that you have read and learned, because I used to give a lot of seminars in other colleges also before.
Sure.
I gave about an hour, 15-minute lecture. I think it's there on the YouTube, but I am not too sure because SMT have live streamed the entire thing.
Sure.
So
sure.
That is how it went up.
Good, good, excellent, Abhishek, excellent. I think I'm sure this is very very inspiring for all of us, and I'm sure we should we should encourage. So guys, the whole purpose, you know, it just started that Abhishek shared this thing with me, and I thought, you know, this is something that I need to share with all of you, because this is not like, you know, boasting about yourself. It's just that, you know, you feel good that you connect with the faculty saying you have done this. And if someone else also has something, and it need not be as recent as last week. So in Abhishek case, he was called by the college. So he runs this Vivekananda Samiti also. I think you send me some pictures of that also. We'll talk about that later, Abhishek, one to one. But if you have you know, such initiatives, it is good for you when you come to the interview stage, guys. Because what the way I can look at it is, Abhishek is already filling up his DAF. You know, there is a position called position of distinction or merit and all that. So you could be a half marathon runner, or you could be in some sports, or you are into gym or cycling or any other activity. It really helps. It could be anything. In fact, when I was part of this mock interview panel, I have come across people who said stand-up comedy as their hobby, but they were serious about stand-up comedy. So obviously, you know, we need to respect what that person likes doing. So next week, or, you know, sometime, it will be good, and we will not spend too much time, but it should act as a booster for you guys also. You know, if someone can also share something in the past, also, it could be your school days, it could be your college days. It makes everyone else, yeah, sure, Abhishek, that's my job actually, to make the aspirant feel good. So it will be good if we can share as a small group, because we are a close-knit group of 15 people. I individually know every single one of you, your background, family background, educational background, everything. It really helps that we grow as a close-knit community of serious aspirants. Because one thing I always feel proud and happy about this group is, this is an extremely serious aspirant group. Huh? And they have come in stages. Either they are part of mentorship, or they are part of test series, or, you know, they have got in touch with me. And, you know, slowly we built this relationship over the past several months. So I'm so happy that, you know, I have a set of very sincere aspirants that also kind of keeps me on the toes many times to really push myself to give the best in terms of whatever I can with my limited resources. Good, Abhishek. I would really encourage, if, you know, whenever you get time, you could also share some of your success stories. It need not be recent, as I said. It could be past, yeah, or it could be future also, that I intend to do this. And we'll give a 5-minute slot whenever we can to share these success stories and feel motivated. Okay. I want to start this topic. So please kind of bear with me for the next 5, 7, 10 minutes so that I feel satisfied that we started basics of environment. So basics of environment, maybe it contributes around overall 5% of the total weightage for environment. You don't get a question every year. But if you get a question, and if it is either a concept, okay, or if it is an application of the concept, if you know the basics of environment, you'll be able to answer it. Otherwise, the questions in basics of environment is like, if you know, you attempt and you get it right. If you don't know, you cannot attempt. It is very difficult to eliminate. Yeah. So it is like a do or die kind of a thing. It's a digital thing, 0-1. Either you know it or you don't know. So why to even waste a question which could be a sitter had you known the background properly? Okay. Good. So what is it that I'll cover under basics of environment? So I will broadly, I'll cover only 3-4 things. Today's class, I'll start biomes, the various kinds of biomes. The second, what I'll do is, we also have this thing called nutrient cycle, which are also called as biogeochemical cycle. Third one is a lot of definitions, guys. Definition and concepts. So concepts, we will talk about relatively easy things like ecological pyramid, the various types of pyramids like pyramid of mass, pyramid of biomass, sorry, pyramid of numbers, pyramid of biomass, pyramid of energy, etc. We'll talk about the concept called ecological succession. We will talk about habitats, niche, adaptation, habitat, niche, adaptation. There is this thing called, it's called as biotic interaction. Biotic interaction, etc. Okay. So this is the broad level. I hope to complete this in 1.5 class. Maybe the Wednesday full class will be this. And maybe the next Wednesday, half a class I may require. Biome, we will start off today. And technically, that can also be part of biodiversity. But I'm putting it under a basics part because it is indeed a basic part. Okay. So let's get started on biome, guys. So first, the definitions. So the first thing that you need to remember about biome is that it is a terrestrial part of the biosphere. This is an important part. The marine part is generally not included under biomes. They are separately called as aquatic ecosystem or marine ecosystem. But when you are referring to biome, it refers to the terrestrial part. Okay. It is an enormous region and it can also have multiple ecosystems in it. That's fine. This point becomes important. If I am dividing the whole planet, the terrestrial part, into various biomes, what are the two major criteria? The two major criteria for classification of biome is temperature and precipitation. Temperature and precipitation. So just by looking at annual precipitation and annual average temperature, I'll be able to easily differentiate between the various biomes. Now, so some of these topics have taken from this thing called NIOS, if you've heard of it, National Institute of Open Schooling. So NIOS ka environment, just as you have NIOS geography, you have an NIOS environment. Some of the basic things have taken from NIOS, just like NCRT, that's also a good primary source. So not all scientists classify biome in the same way. Major biomes of the world that I have taken from them, it has 6 biomes. Okay. So if you keep the Earth, if you can turn this entire thing by 90 degree, I hope, which you can do, I'm sure. So you have the equator and you have the North Pole here. You have the North Pole and you have the equator. As you come from the North Pole to the equator, these are the biomes you will see. Yeah, the only thing I request you to do is just tilt it 90 degrees in the clockwise direction and you will be able to see. So you start with tundra biome. Tundra, close to the Arctic Sea. Another information. The poles are not included as part of biomes. The poles are not included as part of biomes, even though technically the Arctic and the Antarctic can be classified as a desert because in terms of rainfall, annual precipitation, they meet the criteria for a desert, cold desert. But both the poles are not included as part of biomes, at least in this classification. Okay. And as I've also mentioned that I've seen in other books, they're classified slightly differently. I thought we want to understand the basics. So let's just make it a little simple. Tundra, taiga and coniferous, temperate deciduous, temperate grassland, savanna grassland, which is, you could call this as tropical grassland, equatorial rainforest. Sometimes they're also called as tropical rainforest. A subset of tropical rainforest is equatorial rainforest. Okay, so from the north, if you come towards the equator, this is how it looks. Now, what did we say here? In this, we have said that the two most important criteria is what? It is temperature and precipitation. So let's try to draw a graph, guys, and together we'll figure out which one comes where. So let me call this as a temperature. X-axis is temperature. Y-axis is precipitation. Okay, precipitation. Sorry, let's put P for precipitation. Temperature is your average annual temperature. Average annual temperature. Let me start it from 30 degree. minus, I'm putting it, looks like a little anomaly, but please bear with me. Let me call this point as minus 10 degrees. And let me call this as 10 degrees. So this becomes 20, and this becomes 0 degree. Okay. So precipitation, the really rainforest types, they have something like 400 centimeters. Okay. And then I have 200, I have 100 centimeter, and I have 300 centimeter. Okay. What I'm doing here is I am dividing it into four boxes. Okay. So I'm calling this dabba, this box, this one as, let's say, quadrant one. I'm calling this as quadrant two. I'm calling this as quadrant three. I'm calling this as quadrant four. Okay. So far, so good. Now you tell me, out of all these biomes, which biome do you think will most likely come in quadrant one? That is, what is quadrant one? High average annual temperature and very high precipitation. Which biome you think will it be? Someone has answered. Excellent, super. It's going to be rainforest. Yeah, equatorial rainforest. You are right. Equatorial rainforest. Why? Annual average temperature at the equator, neither is the temperature too high nor too low. Average wise, it's around 25, 30 degrees, and rainfall is very high. So suppose equatorial rainforest will come somewhere here. Okay, so this is my equatorial rainforest. Now, tropical rainforest could be somewhere like this. Do you agree? Because they may have slightly less temperature possible. They may have a slightly less rainfall also. So this could be tropical rainforest. As I said, equatorial rainforest has more rainfall, more vegetation, and more average temperature than tropical rainforest. To that extent, this is it. Okay. So now let's come to quadrant three. Which one do you think is likely to be in quadrant three? That is low temperature and low rainfall. Low temperature and low rainfall. Yeah, take your time. Think through. Let me know. Taiga, okay. Tundra, taiga. Okay, so we've got two answers here. So let's look at it. Anything else other than tundra and taiga? Any other answer? Okay. So low temperature. So of all this area, which is near the North Pole, obviously it's going to have low temperature. And if you look at the uppermost part of Siberia, uppermost part of Canada, going to Greenland, do you have rainfall? No, you don't have rainfall. So for all practical purpose, this becomes your tundra. Low mean annual temperature and low precipitation. So to that extent, Rachi is right. Now let's come to taiga. Taiga, what happens is, it is maybe in quadrant three or somewhere between the intersection. Taiga is, you are coming a little down, as in from North Pole towards the equator. So obviously the temperature has to move a little bit here. And how about the rainfall? The rainfall is a little better. So taiga will also come, but it will come somewhere here. Are you able to understand? Slightly better precipitation and slightly more temperature. There is one more biome which can pretty much come here. It is tundra, but the other biome that can pretty much come here is the cold desert, like a Gobi desert in Central Asia, Patagonia, South America, Gobi desert, what is that called? Taklamakan, Patagonia, some of these cold deserts. Yeah. So they also come under this. So these three biomes come here, and rest you can very easily distribute. So we have touched the equatorial rainforest. We've touched tundra, taiga also we have touched. Between temperate deciduous and temperate grassland, what will it be? Temperature will still be a little less. So temperature will still be less. Maybe the mean average temperature, temperate deciduous and temperate grassland, let's say will be around 10 degrees. And the rainfall will also be somewhere here. Yeah, so this will be a temperate deciduous. Savanna grassland, the temperature will be more. temperature will definitely be more, and the rainfall is below normal. So it is most likely to be in the zone 4. So I may call this part as savanna grassland. And where will your proper desert, hot desert come? Hot desert may come somewhere here, because very low precipitation and very high temperature. Okay. Now the reason why we did this exercise, the whole purpose of doing this exercise was, there is this picture here. Okay. So this picture only we have just drawn here. This is a little complicated because they have put a lot of curves and all. All that I've done is I've divided this into 4 quadrants like this and given you a rough order of magnitude as to where these biomes come. Yeah. So we don't have to explain, discuss this in detail at all, because we have done this exercise as a team in this slide. Okay. So good. So this is how it is distributed. So let's very quickly look at it. So you have this light blue tundra, the dark green taiga, then you have this light green, which is your temperate deciduous forest. Yeah, this yellow is your desert. This dark brown over here, this is your temperate grassland. This is your temperate grassland. This, I don't know what color to say this. This is your savanna or the tropical grassland. Tropical grassland. Yellow is your desert. Okay. So this is how world over the various biomes are distributed. So let's just look at the first biome today's class. Next class, we'll look at the remaining biomes. The first biome is tundra. Okay. Now, how will you explain tundra in few words to me? Or let me put it this way very quickly. Can someone tell me 2 or 3 keywords of tundra? Low temperature, yes, that's a given. Other than that, suppose I drop you, airlift you, and I drop you in a tundra biome. What will you see? If you were to give me a 1-sentence description of what it looks like, what will it be? No trees. Excellent point, Prachi. Excellent. No trees. Cold desert, yes. Would you see a lot of ice, snow? Absolutely. Mosses. Good. Good. So no trees. Yes. Mosses also. Mosses and lichens. So good. Which means it's going to be an extremely cold region. No vegetation. The only vegetation being mosses and lichens, which can grow. And snow. Okay. So which is pretty much correct. Now I have one representative image for each biome. So this is the representative image. Yeah. I somehow feel very sad for this fox, which is so alone. So this is a picture of Arctic fox. The Arctic fox is one of the species that is there in the tundra biome. So what are the key characteristics here? Coldest of all biomes, which is a given. Soil is frozen and only the top 0.5 meters melts during the summer. Below that, the soil is permanently frozen and hence the term permafrost. Simple and easy to understand. Why only the top 5%? Because the sunlight can hit only at the surface, because of that some amount melts. And because the soil is permanently frozen, what will happen? No roots. So no roots means no trees, which kind of correlates with all what you guys said. There is snow, there is lack of vegetation, and there is loneliness. Yeah, you can see loneliness in the eyes of the fox, looking very sad. Okay. What about the biotic diversity? Biotic diversity is going to be low because of the very reason that you have only limited vegetation that is this biome can support a very limited vegetation. Short season of growth, self-explanatory, because majority of the time it will be harsh winters, low precipitation. Now, which part of the world did we see? We have tundra. I said we will see tundra near the poles. We are not taking South Pole into account, by the way, because South Pole does not have any major masses. So it is Antarctica, and after Antarctica, the nearest, the closest islands in the South Pole are somewhere this, no? Either this or this. Okay. So tundra, is it there only in North Pole or in some other part of the world also? Am I missing something in tundra? When I said it's there only in the poles or near the poles, can it be somewhere here? Can tundra be somewhere in this part of the world? In terms of simple yes or no? Yes. Okay. Shanli says yes. Oh, yes. So good. Cold desert. Yes. Very true. what I, which is right, cold desert is definitely there, and tundra kind of weather can be pretty much possible even in the tropics, because the temperature is decided not just by the latitude but also by the high mountain tops, excellent, but also by the altitude. Therefore, tundra is also of two types: Arctic tundra, which is a function of latitude, and Alpine tundra, which is a function of altitude. Okay, so if someone says tundra cannot exist in the tropical region, you have to think twice, because one, it's an absolute statement, and two, sometimes when it looks very obvious, you have to think twice if there is some question in it. So as many of you have rightly got it, altitude can also make a tropical region into a tundra biome, Himalayas for example. Okay, and where it is spread world over, I have shown that. Okay, so let me stop here. I think we've already overshoot by 15-17 minutes. In the next class, we'll continue the remaining parts of basics, and I expect to complete the basics in the next class, hopefully in the next class. Okay, so thank you guys for joining the class. So if anyone has any questions, you can